IVM. Hey everyone, welcome to today's episode of This Round Is On Me. So as we air this, there is a furor erupting in the US over one Washington Post food critic's shocking statement in a recent article he posted on the foods he most dislikes. He said that Indian cuisine is based on one spice, namely curry, and that Indian food is made up of only curries, which is a type of stew. The WashPo went on to issue a retraction when what they should have in fact issued was a big fat apology. And what they also should have done is put the bloody writer on a one-way flight to India and made him document the food he eats literally from Kashmir to Kanyakumari. Oh, this is so exasperating to read dimwit opinions like this in a widely circulated and respected paper like the WashPo. It reminds me of something I heard recently, actually, on another true crime podcast, where the host explained in the context of suspect identification lineups that people of a different race or ethnicity are far more likely to pick incorrectly as they're unable to identify distinguishing features. This Indian spice nonsense sounds about the same to me. Anyway, to chat about hopefully a lot less nonsensical and a lot more fun food facts, I can't wait to bring on my guest today. So stay tuned after this quick break.
Hey, it's been another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. On This Round Is On Me, Shailee Chopra shares with Gauri how they hit 750 million on She The People TV. We have a new show, The Last Brand Standing. Anupam Gupta and Ambi Parmeshwar get together and discuss some of the biggest and most public feuds in Indian brand history. Do check that out. Taste the lip-smacking palate of Karachi with Bilal Hassan on Naan Curry with Sadaf and Archit. On Misconduct, learn all about Dawood Ibrahim's sister, Hasina Parker, with Raghvi and Nisha. Is the Indian Constitution queer-friendly? Find out on the Longest Constitution podcast with Priya Mirza. And on Audio Gyan, Harish S., design head at CRED, talks about his Carnatic rock band and design as an art form. Do follow us on social media. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. And remember, if you're enjoying this show or any other show for that matter, please do tell a friend. And finally, we'd like to thank our sponsors on the network this week, SEAT, CRED, Bank of Baroda, Quarter, CoinSwitch, Kuber, and Intuit India. Thank you so much for making this possible.
Welcome back to this episode of This Round Is On Me. Aarti Sampath is a New York-based renowned chef, restaurant consultant, food truck expert, and TV personality. One of the industry's rising stars, now gaining popularity with her stint as a judge on MasterChef Tamil. She gained critical acclaim by winning Chopped, a famed culinary cooking competition. And she's currently the head chef at Chinese Tuxedo, a modern fine dining Asian restaurant in New York City. She's also the consultant chef for numerous restaurants, including Sigri NJ LLC, Bombay Curry Company, Bazi NYC, and creates several high-end private dining experiences. And she's also originally from Amchi, Mumbai. Aarti, welcome to the show. It's so great to have you join me today.
Thank you. Thank you, Gauri. I am so happy to be a part of this conversation. And I think we've been wanting to have, I've been wanting to have this conversation with you for quite a while. So thank you so much.
I know our whole encounter was actually like so random, and I'm so glad it happened when you sort of messaged me out of the blue on Instagram. Instagram's Zindabad, of course, and and then you happened to be in Bombay, I think visiting your family, right? And and I was like, yeah, come on over, let's meet up. And it was such a fun lunch. So I'm really glad we stayed in touch. And and here we are today. So let's get into this. Aarti, I have to ask you first and foremost, you know, how did you discover your love for cooking and food, and growing up in Bombay? How did that happen?
I'm really grateful that I got to grow up in such a diverse environment, and I think Bombay definitely provides that. I have my roots down in the south. I'm from, my parents are from Chennai, so definitely had a lot of South Indian influence in my food growing up at home, for sure. And I'm such a person, like, I found that very boring, but I do appreciate it now. But back then, I just found my own food, like my mom's cooking, whatever, boring. So any opportunity we got to go out and eat And when I went to school and I was stealing, you know, my friends' dabbas and eating their food, which is also like, I think is a huge influence on how I cook and how I perceive food. So a lot of school memories. And then my parents always try to take us on a vacation every year. So all of those travels as well have deeply, deeply influenced the way I cook.
But I mean, like, what made you want, like, I love food. I love, like, you know, trying new foods, traveling for food, all of that. But I can't cook and I have no desire to cook. So, I mean, I know a lot of people, you know, love food, but it doesn't necessarily translate into cooking. So where did the cooking part of it come in?
Clearly, I love to eat as a kid. I was always a chubby kid. And as I was growing, like I was in my teens, early teens, my grandmom sent me to a cooking class. I would go to Chennai for vacation. Every summer I was back in Chennai at her place. And she would just want to make, you know, all her grandkids have like some certain skills. Oh, you're a girl, you're in your teens, you'll have to know how to cook. So she sent us for cooking class. And I think among all the all the teenagers, like all my cousins at the time, I grew a sudden liking for it because it was so creative and the science of it. Like I remember we did gulab jamun in one of the classes and it was just so insane to think about how the temperature of the oil has to be, how there can't be cracks when you like roll the gulab jamun. So I think those questions and ideas of how food gets done really intrigued me.
That's amazing. And then you actually like, you know, decided to go on to culinary school, right?
Yes, that's right.
Sorry, you were saying something earlier?
I always thought that I'd take up something very creative. And I loved acting as a kid. So I loved theater and I would do a lot of theater back in school. And in some way that was like discouraged, like that's not really, you're from an orthodox like South Indian family. They didn't think that that was like a great career choice. So I had to pick something that was just as rebellious and was extremely creative. So that's when I kind of took it upon me. Okay, you know what? What about cooking? This is very creative and I can put my 100% focus on it.
So, I mean, of course, you've managed to combine the two very successfully now, which we'll obviously talk about, you know, your TV stint a little later. But you mentioned about sort of cooking not necessarily being taken seriously as a professional, you know, as a profession either. So how did you convince, you know, your family, or did you not really, you know, were they kind of supportive, or, you know, how did that sort of transpire when you decided to go to culinary school?
Yeah. So like roughly 10, 12 years ago, there wasn't really a specific culinary school per se in India, probably like the Vaksha, Manipal or something. However, when you looked at like government colleges, there weren't any. So we also did not know how you go about becoming a chef, but hospitality school was there. So, or hotel management school was there. And I think my parents were not thrilled about it at all. However, they thought, you know what, hospitality school can lead you into various directions.
Working in a five-star hotel.
Yeah, that's true. And they thought, you know, this girl is anyway going to do her master's. She's going to do her MBA or something. So she can get out of that. So somehow, you know, it happened. And I went to studied hotel management in Jaipur. And it wasn't, you know, until I got into like into a hotel, I did my internship at the Oberoi Raj Villas. And the first day, which was like a 14-hour day. And for a little kid who had no clue what a cooking will be and how they're going to treat you and how difficult it was, I just knew that day, I just knew that if I came back home and I told my dad that I don't think I can do this. And he's going to say, I told you so. And that was the only reason why I just decided to trudge on.
So it was more really, it was more like the pride of like them proving them wrong and well, that's a good enough reason. So
so the true love for cooking really came on 3 or 4 years after. So the first 3-4 years were just suffering.
But that's fair. Listen, you know, I want to ask you a little bit more about culinary school, because a lot of people ask me for advice on, you know, hotel management and going through the whole education process. And I don't know if you know this, but I have none. And, you know, we've kind of really like learned on the job, so to speak. And a lot of chefs also do that, right? Like, I mean, I've met so many chefs who've done dinners with us and just, you know, like in all my travels. And so many of them talk about how they just kind of had to get a job, you know, and it could have been actually as a dishwasher, and then they slowly like worked their way up. And so I actually want to ask you a kind of on behalf almost of budding chefs and, you know, people looking to get into this profession, that like, how important do you think it is to go to culinary school versus kind of just getting your hands dirty at a restaurant?
I think there are two sides to the coin for sure. I think I know a lot of successful chefs who've never been to school, and they just out of like the last year in high school, they just got into working and then worked their way up. However, if you choose that path, you have to be made of steel. Like, you will have to experience cooking in like so many different spaces. You'll have to give the first few years of your life to just learning banqueting, to learning, you know, just the basics of which culinary school provides for you. So if that is your form of education, you can't be stuck in one restaurant, you can't be stuck in one space and do the same thing. Whereas now you have to compete with a culinary school graduate who has learned the basics, who has already had some exposure to banquet cooking, who's got exposure to probably like a 5-star hotel during an internship, and an extra education of the other departments of how a restaurant runs. They do business management, and they could even be like, they could specialize in perhaps, suppose it's baking and pastry, you can really specialize in it in school. You learn the basics and you go out a little more prepared. So there are two sides. Both are, I think, winners, whether you go to culinary school versus not going. Not going to culinary school is definitely an amazing, and it's a tougher path. And you just have to really work. You get paid, obviously, to learn. So that's another good thing.
As opposed to paying to learn. But I understand that, you know, there's a lot more, I guess, commitment, because it's not as regimented and structured as going to school. And you really, it's kind of about self-discipline and you know, your own motivation to keep learning and, you know, getting that same kind of breadth of experience that you can get at school. But you actually then went on to do a master's in culinary arts in the US. Is that correct?
Yeah, so it wasn't a master's. It's actually an undergrad program, but it was getting like just, it's garnishing your degree. So I had a degree in India, and you just garnish it with a little more education to that degree. So I decided to major in baking and pastry, which is something that I'd really not done in my years at the Taj. So I did that and food service management. There were two majors that I took, which was like, I think it's totally a different world of studying versus like studying in India with infrastructure in the States. I think if you get an opportunity to like study at like colleges like the CIA or the Johnson & Wales, of course, they're extremely expensive. But if you do it the smart way, like I studied during, I would work on campus. So I got like a few subjects free. And then if you keep your GPA above a 4.0, you keep getting reduction in your a fee as well. So there are different structures to it. And plus, it was only a garnished my degree, which is another great move for young chefs to do. You can do your hospitality management in India, and then colleges like Johnson & Wales provide like a garnish your degree situation. So
it's like a supplemental course.
It's a supplement, So you get your degree from the US, which is also great. And you don't have to do the 3 years. So I did a year.
Very interesting. So, you know, I understand, were trained in like Thai, Vietnamese, French cuisine while you were in India. I'm guessing this is working with the hotels. Is that right?
Yes, that's right.
But then you went on to work with, you know, a Michelin star chef like Vikas Khanna serving, cooking Indian food at Junoon in New York. And your food truck as well was Indian inspired, if I remember right, from
It had Ajay. Definitely. Yes.
So, how did that switch happen in terms of, doing more Indian when you were away from India and doing less Indian when you were in India?
Again, it's that bug of curiosity. I think I loved Asian flavors. And my first stint was with Ananda Solomon and Taj at the Thai Pavilion at the time. And just seeing those ingredients, and they're so similar to what we cook and also not. Mm-hmm. So it just got me so curious. And then I went on to work at The Sin, which was a brand new Asian restaurant in Taj Deccan in Hyderabad. So it just kept adding layers to my cooking style. However, when I came to the US, and I started missing Indian food because I wasn't eating that at all on a regular basis. And when I had to start, when I was in college, I had to start do an internship, and I had applied to a lot of different places, and I wanted to do, I think the criteria for me really, I just wanted to do some sort of a Michelin star restaurant for to work with. And Junoon called me back, and I just, you know, that rest is history. I got to eat Indian food and also learn an elevated style of how you could, you know, what it takes to run a Michelin star restaurant.
But I have to ask you, with my sort of experience of working with, you know, so many different chefs, do you think like chefs should focus on becoming experts at one cuisine to really excel? Of course, inspiration can come from all over, but is it important to be associated with one cuisine? And that's kind of been my experience with a lot of chefs that I've either, you know, dined with or, I had come and cook with us at Mag Street Kitchen. But having said that, I've also seen, you know, chefs in India, like, for example, like Chef Thomas Zacharias, who's like really renowned for his work at the Bombay Canteen. But he was previously with the Olive Group, right, which is Mediterranean. And then he kind of, you know, just really like blossomed at the Bombay Canteen doing Indian food. So I've seen both sides of it, but I'd love to know what you think, you know, how chefs would kind of think of their, I guess, progression, cuisine progression.
I think that's, I am completely in disagreement with chefs wanting to just, I mean, I think it works for them and that's great, is sticking to one cooking style. Because I think for me, it has helped me to be a part of so many. After Junoon, I never did really Indian food, but I always have Indian elements wherever I go and cook. You know, I do that. I've done, I worked at the Rainbow Room. I worked at the Breslin, which is another Michelin star British American restaurant. So having that varied experience in different styles of cooking, I've imbibed like a lot of techniques from there and flavors that one cuisine cannot provide. For example, Indian food is just so big on flavors. It's extremely robust. However, when it comes to like techniques, when the way you're cooking your proteins, the respect for like simpler flavors is not there. Mm-hmm. And which you learn like when you do French or you do
Vietnamese is like so light on. Yeah,
exactly. But it's also bold flavors, right? Same with like South American food, like Mexican food has a lot of Indian undertones. So someone who loves cooking Indian food, it's going to be very easy for them to learn and pick up those flavors. I don't think we should be put in a box. And I think very often, especially now when I was in the States, that was my biggest struggle, because the way I look, people mostly think, oh, she cooks only Indian food, which is not true. So I think a lot of chefs here are breaking those barriers too. And if suppose I'm the head chef of, I'm like the corporate chef for like a restaurant group, it doesn't serve any purpose for me to just know one cuisine. The whole restaurant group wants to open like an Asian inspired spot. They want to do like you're the perfect example of it. Like table is, the food is not just an influence of some, it's like very new American in a way. Like the food is got like that Californian vibe, and it's got, I'm sure there are a couple of Indian elements. There was a taco dish. Like unless you have that knowledge and you have that exposure as a chef, you can't do menus like that. Then you're very confined to this particular box.
Fair. Which, I mean, that's absolutely fair. And but I kind of want to ask you the flip side now, because I saw in, especially in the lockdown, I saw a lot of regional cuisines take importance. And of course, even maybe before lockdown as well. But I think they really came to the forefront during this time when a lot of like home chefs were really like, you know, blossoming and doing their thing. And it wasn't in a fusion or modern way, but as a as a way of celebrating, you know, authentic flavors and techniques and recipes and, you know, kind of this this amazing combination of like nostalgia and you know, and it was fueled by sort of, I think, consumers or diners wanting to experiment and try things that they weren't familiar with. So, you know, so there was this sort of really this going back to roots and going back to authenticity of dishes. So what's your perspective on how food and tastes are evolving now?
I think, I've had a little bit of an I was in Bangalore for the last couple of months before I came back. So I understand where you're going with, you know, how the lockdown has kind of created this whole new range of chefs who are experimenting with what they've been cooking with, or what, you know, their families have been cooking with. I think that is necessary in a way. Regional foods, like foods from, like Coimbatore, or foods from like somewhere in, you know, deep in Karnataka, didn't come to the forefront until now. And people are paying respect to that. It's wonderful. And at the end of the day, we all, I go to a restaurant this week. I'm most likely not going to go next week. I want something new. So having that variety is great. But at the end of the day, it has to be done well. Like it has to be perfect. How much ever you try to bring these dishes to the forefront, they have to be done just well.
Absolutely. I, as someone who is not a chef, but who, you know, runs multiple F&B businesses, that's what we're always telling our chefs, you know, we're sort of, it's not about being the same as so many other, you know, biryani houses, or being, you know, different or any of that. It's just about whatever you do has to be tasty. You know, that's what it's about. So, you know, coming back to your path, especially sort of in the last few months, it's been really interesting. And, you've had a sort of a foray into TV long before, you know, becoming a judge on MasterChef Tamil. By the way, congratulations. I mean, I don't understand the posts that you put up, which are in Tamil, but I keep seeing them and I'm really like excited for you. I think it's so incredible. what a cool experience, because you're sitting here watching it and you feel so removed from everything that's happening. And now you're like, oh, I know someone who's a judge on MasterChef. But, you know, you also, you started on the other side of the table as a contestant of, you know, many years ago. And of course, now you're on the more fun side, I'm guessing, as a judge. but how did this whole thing come about? You know, where did your interest in, you know, being on these TV shows? Because honestly, to me, as someone who just watches them, they look like bloody hard. And like, I'm just like, I'm really happy just watching this and not have having anything to do with the cooking. But, you know, how did your like involvement with these shows as a contestant happen? And actually tell us a little bit, because you've been on a bunch of shows, right?
Right. When I first entered my dorm, like when I was studying at Johnson & Wales, I remember one of my roommates watching Food Network all day. Like every time she got some time off, it would always be playing in the background. So, and I remember seeing Chopped and I asked her about it. And she said, yeah, this is like, you got to be like this big shot chef to even get on this competition. So that was my first goal. I'm like, okay, this is my way of getting on TV. I know I couldn't act as a kid. I couldn't get into like film school, but I'm going to do it this way. You know, rewind to like fast forward to Junoon. Once I'd grown and I was already a head chef there, I applied online and there was like a grueling interview and then finally got on the show. And I just knew that if I get this opportunity, I've got to win. So I tried my best. I did my all. And then from Chopped, I did Beat Bobby Flay, which is another Food Network show where you like get to beat this Iron Chef. Like he's never lost. He never loses. Like out of 10 shows, he'll probably lose one. Like he's always wins. So you're cooking against him. So I won that. And then I did Chopped Masters like twice and I lost them. I did Fire Masters, a Canada-based show. I lost that. I made it to the finals though. I've been a judge on Beat Bobby Flay. They called me back as a judge. I also did, I was a judge on Worst Cooks of America. These are all Food Network based shows.
So listen, you seem to have like cracked the whole, you know, food contest show, sort of formula. So like, tell us about it. I mean, like, I want to know, is it really all the drama that we see, or, you know, do you have to like live together for weeks and you can't sort of, you know, tell me like, come on, spill the beans.
Definitely while you're cooking, the time is real. Like that's one thing everyone asks me. Right. Do you really get 20 minutes? Do you really get 30 minutes? And yeah, we do. The clock is extremely real. The days can be really long because you're filming, they're tasting, and then you have there's an interview about how it went. So that takes a lot of time. So that gets filmed during the course of the day. And you get to meet like cool chefs, you know, with you who are competing with you. So that's always nice to meet, you know, new people from the industry. It's very, you know, there's that the minute the time starts, it just like this adrenaline just flows through you and you're just trying to figure out, oh my God, I got all these weird ingredients. What do I do with them?
So you actually, it is surreal that like your mystery box is really a mystery and
absolutely.
Those expressions of surprise are for real.
It's totally real. And you'd really have, you don't have any time to like, oh, you know what, we'll give you 15 minutes to think about what to make. No, the time starts like ticking immediately.
I mean, I'm guessing, right? And then is it you obviously have to go and then present your dish, and I'm guessing that's kind of nerve-wracking as well. And and now you're on the other side as a judge, so that like, you have some empathy. But how did this happen? It's huge, it's amazing.
I think they were just looking for an international chef, you know, to be featured.
Who could speak Tamil as well.
Speak Tamil. They wanted, like, I think they wanted a woman as well, so which is great.
Woohoo!
not too many women chefs being, you know, represented. Still, I mean, it's getting better. So this is nice. It's nice that I had the opportunity to do that.
And you were able to like take time off from work, or was it just that because of what's happening in the States right now, with, or rather actually all over the world, you know, with restaurants and things? I mean,
they were super excited for me. They were so excited. Yeah, of course, it was so difficult for them to like, you know, we just started back on and, you know,
I remember that because when we met, I think it was March, I think, and you said that you were going back because the restaurant was going to open soon, and this was your quick break before, you know, finally reopening. So,
So, it was just, you know, they were excited. They were happy that, you know, they would have someone who's on the whole MasterChef, you know, fraternity sort of thing, a part of that. So, I got endless support from them.
That's
which
wonderful.
Is really nice. Yeah.
And so are you still filming? Like you're going back and forth and filming, or has it all been done?
No. I'll be going back next week to film the rest. There's like a lot left.
Wow.
There's like almost 50% of the show left to film.
And how involved are you in actually like conceptualizing it and, you know, sort of guiding the direction of the show, or is it pretty much like judging is what it sort of comes down to?
No, we are very, as the three of us, we're very involved. We all have different abilities. Like one of the chefs is like super South Indian, really knows, you know, South Indian food from a lot of regional parts of Tamil Nadu. And there's one chef who can, who's also got South Indian as well as like a North Indian kind of perspective. And there comes me, who has this more international cuisine sort of outlook. So it's a good mix of all of us. So when we come together with ideas, I think we always come up with something good.
It sounds incredible. So, you know, and speaking of MasterChef, I've been seeing you post so much about it. And, you know, you're always taking these selfie videos, which honestly, I can barely like get myself to take like a video with someone looking at me, like let alone a selfie video. I have like zero confidence when it comes to all of that. But I think it's amazing, you know, what you're doing. And so how do you go about, you know, your whole social media and like, you know, what's been fun for you in creating content? I know you put up recipes, you know, you're always cooking and it's just very like fun and like free flowing and honest. And, you know, so what's worked for you in creating your sort of fan following?
Honestly, my fan base is best. Has just started probably 3 weeks ago. I don't really have, you know, too many, I don't have too many followers as such. But what I do is I just look at others who are doing like similar content. I get some inspiration by how they speak. In truthfully, I'm a huge introvert. Like that's, I don't really like to talk much about my, you know, personal life, or like I can go have dinner with one or two people, but I don't do well in like huge crowds. But social media is one thing that I had to push, because if you don't sell yourself, people won't know who you are. And I think social media is wants you to do that. And the biggest, best chefs out there, like whether it be Jean George or whether it be like Gordon Ramsay, they all are, we don't know who they are in real life, but they're there to like showcase, you know, sell who they are. So I think that's a lesson for me. And for all those introverts out there, I know this is, this could be really hard, like talking, you know, looking like an idiot, like talking to yourself or clicking pictures.
1,000 times over.
Just remember that no one gives a damn. Like they don't care.
I love
people
that.
People are watching it, don't care. They just want to see your authentic self. Like just be a little, you don't have to like dance and, you know, do TikTok videos, but give them a little piece of who you are. And I think if people are following you, they want to see that.
I will try it out and let you know how it goes.
But I don't agree with, you know, what you're saying. I, I saw you do like the video of you on a farm with your
daughter. Yeah, that was one. I did one. I was obviously half asleep, and so I wasn't in my senses. And you know, you're so right. Like, it, people did respond to it, but
right,
it was just, it was like I was filming vegetables, right? So I was okay with that because I wasn't really in it. And I can get away with doing that. But you know, I keep getting asked, like, even for a lot of like PR things, like they'll say, oh, like, you know, answer all these questions and then just send us a video of you saying this or doing that. And I'll send all the questions on time. And then I'll keep being like, yeah, I'll get that video across like shortly. And then the event's all done and happened. And luckily I never had to do it. But yeah, I mean, they just give up on me eventually, but no, I'm gonna sort of take your advice and dive in at some point. But you know, Aarti, I mean, just sort of coming back to sort of the more serious side of the business and what's been going on. You know, you've been in New York, you know, for the last year and a half that we've been in this crazy ass situation. What's it been like for you and, you know, the restaurants that you work with and have worked with, and, you know, how is it now? And we keep hearing about, you know, New York's kind of the first city, I think, that we heard, you know, and that sort of experienced this on a larger scale. Mm-hmm. And so we keep looking to it to see what's happening. And we feel like, you know, hey, that's what's kind of, that's just sort of a preview of what's going to happen in Bombay or in India or whatever. And, and it's really sort of sad. Like, every time you feel like, hey, New York's back on its feet, it's like opened up and, you know, everything's kind of looking like it's back to normal. And what's actually happening on the ground?
Definitely a lot of restaurant spaces that went out of business didn't decide to come back. And some have, like, if it was a huge restaurant, like it was a 150 seater, they decided to find a space that was like in a, that was probably half the size. And that's what we've been seeing. Also,
so just like relocating.
Relocating, yeah.
Right.
Relocating has been big. And also the capacity of has changed. Also, you see a new age of restaurants, like chefs that did more of fine dining and more of casual, fancy food, have decided to do more of like this quick service setup, like, because there's also like a dearth of labor. People are not like getting off unemployment yet. So it's been very difficult to like hire good talent. So they just decide to ghost kitchens have been massive. But I'm seeing this whole quick service thing come up where even though there are tables or something, you go and pick up your food and then eat and then get rid of, you know, your plate or so.
But you work in, I mean, you're the head chef of a fine dining restaurant. So what's that experience been like? I mean, are people still, is it a tasting menu format or is it a la carte?
No, it's not. It's a la carte.
Right. So, I mean, we've been hearing, like, I've been reading about like 11 Madison Park, for example, and it's like, you know, it's now obviously it's shifted to this vegan format. By the way, please tell me what you think of that. But, you know, I guess what you're saying is that there's just a general kind of like shift away from maybe those $300-$400 menus and to like a little more comfort and, sort of more casual formats.
Whatever the price of the menu, like, I think New Yorkers don't have that, issue with, spending as such. There's always like that, there's always a market for whatever you do. Like if you are an 11 Madison Park and, you need to spend $300, per person, that's going, there is a market.
There's an audience for that. Yeah.
Yeah. There's an audience for that for sure. And that's why they've been booked out, I think, for the next couple of months, I believe.
What do you think of the whole vegan menu?
I think we have, as Indians, we've been eating like vegan, vegetarian food like forever. It's just that we've not been vocal about it. We just taken for granted. And then there's someone, and this happens time and again, like people come up and they talk about, you know, we're going all vegan and we're, this is, it's sustainable, it's better for the environment, and also we're going to rip you off. Like, it's all, people are, you know, they just pick up and listen. I think we don't do it enough. I'm just trying to understand. I haven't eaten there yet. I've eaten at the old restaurant. I haven't had the new menu, but the tasting menu is even more expensive than what it was before. Wow. So that's really gutsy to do that. I definitely think so.
Yeah, I guess maybe for us, like you said, we've been doing it or we're eating that way unwittingly. And then, you know, now that there's a label put on it and, you know, you just think like it's now a different sort of lifestyle choice. And, you know, it's something that we've actually inadvertently been doing all along. So, interesting. No, I'm very sort of curious to see how this I guess evolves not just, you know, not just with a restaurant like Love Madison Park, but just you know, as a, that it's not a trend and that it's something that's actually signaling a change of food preferences, maybe.
I think veganism has been very big in, I mean, you can just say that with all the restaurants that have been there for years in America and especially New York. They always do well. They're always packed because, there's this huge vegetarian crowd that just would prefer to eat there than eat at like a restaurant that serves one or two dishes. Mm-hmm. So it's really been, it's a trend that's here to stay. That's what I see it as.
Yeah.
And it'll only grow, I think.
Very interesting.
And it's good for your food cost as well, I think, in a lot of ways.
Very important.
So, So,
Aarti, how do you keep your creativity and innovation alive? You know, I mean, what do you sort of, what gets you excited these days?
I try to make it a point to try a new restaurant every month or every couple of weeks. I think that always, keeps you, it's like a perspective of someone else's, like you get to taste and understand, oh, so there's this way also that, you know, XYZ can be done. So I just make it a point, and I think all young chefs should constantly do that. However busy you are, I hear, young chefs always say, but I'm working, 80 hours, 90 hours a week, and I don't have any time. I'm sure you have like that one day off, like use it instead of going, you know, sleeping all day, like go out there and have one meal, like, and just sit and like watch the service, watch how they, how they conduct themselves. You learn so much in that way.
That's amazing.
And that's what I do.
Yeah. And you get to eat as well. So.
Yeah. And I get to eat too. Yeah.
I've always seen how, you know, you talk about long hours, but I think being a chef is really requires a tremendous amount of toughness, physical, emotional, mental. Mm-hmm. Would you agree? Has that been your experience?
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. You have to be made of something else to I think work in the kitchen. Mental toughness, yes, especially in the initial years when you have no idea what you're doing. You really have to learn from others. So it's very difficult to go through pain and not even know why you're doing it, as opposed to like a few years after when you start learning and understanding how flavors work together, how you create a recipe, then it gets like more and more interesting. And back then also, there was a lot of like harassment. There was like so many cases of molesting, especially for young girls. Mm. Who got in the industry and then they would leave. It was that part of it. Like, I don't wish that on anyone, and it still happens. It's happened a lot in the past. However, now people are voicing it, you know, and I think even in India, if there are chefs who are going through something of that sort, that's actually hindering your creativity, that is something that will hinder your creativity. I think you should vocalize it, talk to it and talk to, and not be with companies who, you know, propagate it.
Of course, so, of course.
Yeah. There's no need for the industry to be so grueling. I think there's a change in thought process, especially with the new chefs, that let's be more balanced. Let's think about like having a work-life balance. Let's think about if someone asks for a day off, like let them have it if you can, you know, be more balanced in, you know, the way you give feedback instead of just yelling and screaming. Those are things that are changing. So this industry that was like kind of looked down as like, you're going through a hellhole, I think that is slowly changing.
That's great. I mean, I think, yeah, it's sort of, I feel like that's happening here as well, but it's a slow process for sure. Mm-hmm. So we're going to take a quick break before we enter the last segment of the show, which is a quick fire. And you have to say the first thing that comes to your mind and lots of exciting questions. So stay tuned.
Do you like true crime stories? Do you like to learn about the people behind some horrible, awful crimes? More specifically, women that may have committed these crimes. Actually, Indian criminals that are women? Then we'd like to welcome you to our podcast, Misconduct. My name is Raghavi. And I am Nisha. We cover themes like murder, dacoity, drug trafficking, financial fraud, kidnapping, and many more. You can catch us every Wednesday on the IVM Podcast Network or wherever you get your podcast.
Okay, we're back with Chef Aarti Sampath, and I am going to ask you a few rapid-fire questions. So just say the first thing that comes to your mind.
Okay.
What gets you up in the morning?
My dreams.
What's your one go-to comfort food?
Pho.
Oh, really? I love pho.
Yeah.
At least you didn't say khichdi. That's what everybody else says.
Right.
What's one pet peeve you have about restaurants?
The long hours.
Fair. One cooking or dining experience that you'll never forget?
Boulay, restaurant Boulay in New York. The flavors were just, it was like magical. I learned so much. It just, the way the chef thought and the service, it just felt like you were in someone's home, but also you were at like a fine dining space. So
amazing. Well, I'm going to add that to the bucket list.
Yeah.
Any chance of opening a restaurant in India at some point?
Having a restaurant in Mumbai is, it's really my dream. I've always wanted to have something in probably my neighborhood, like in the Chembur area. I think that's something I would love to do. Yeah.
Oh, exciting. What's your definition of success, Chef?
I think success is really that journey that you have, and you're happy in that journey. You're learning in that journey. It's not the end goal. It's your life, like, that you go through.
And what's your message to young chefs today?
I think as young chefs, we often look for a lot of mentorship, and with the hopes that if you're linked with a certain chef, you'll get like another job, or you'll be able to grow up the ranks. I think that whole mentorship idea is overrated. You have to create a path for yourself, and what you love and what you want may be very different from what your mentor has for you. So yes, take inspiration and always take advice from people, but we don't have to follow that exact journey. Like, my journey is so varied, so different. It cannot be exactly the same for you. So be your own mentor. Like, think of you being the strongest person you have for yourself. Think of what you want for yourself, and work on that path. Like, don't compare it to someone else's life.
Well said. And, you know, that's definitely, I think, applicable to more than just chefs today. So,
right.
You know, that great words there. So thank you so much for being on the show. And, you know, Chef, this was really fun chatting with you. And I can't wait to hang out again when you're back in town. Or
yeah, maybe, definitely.
Maybe stateside if we ever make it out. But listen, wish you the very, very best. And you know, good luck with all the exciting things you have lined up ahead.
Thank you so much, Gauri. I really hope I can cook with you and cook for you.
Like, yes, we have to have you come and cook at Mag Street Kitchen for sure.
I would love that. I would love that. Probably in the next couple of months when I'm there.
Amazing.
Maybe we can plan something out. Yeah, but thank you for this opportunity. I had so much fun talking
thank
about
you.
Myself. Like bragging about myself, rather. Thank
you. As you said, you have to do that, right? Because no one else is going to do it for you.
Right.
Great. Well, good luck. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
It's been so interesting to follow Aarti's journey. And as she said, it hasn't been the least bit conventional. And it's not followed in anyone else's footsteps. She literally really has forged her own path and stayed true to her strengths and personal goals. Whether it was longing to work in an Indian restaurant in the US or working with a Michelin chef, winning the cooking competitions on TV, or even being the head chef of a fine dining Chinese restaurant. I think we could all agree that being true to and satisfied with your own unique journey is really the best possible route to success and happiness as a chef, or otherwise. Speaking of which, I have some exciting few weeks ahead, which is why I'm going to be taking a little pause from the show to focus on that. I'll be back very soon when I'll share more about this with you and of course celebrate 50 episodes of this show. Whoa, who would have thought, huh? So until then, stay safe and definitely do try to catch up on some of the earlier episodes. And please do keep writing in once you've heard them and share your feedback. I really love hearing from you guys. I hope you enjoyed tuning in today. Do catch the earlier episodes when you get a chance. And more importantly, I would love to hear from you with your thoughts on the show. You can find me on Instagram at Gauri Devidayal or on Twitter at Gauri Details or LinkedIn. Either way, sit back and relax because this round is on me.
Wonder why China does the things that it does, or want to know how we could improve online privacy, or perhaps you're thinking about how we can kickstart India's economy. If you'd like to search for the answers to such questions, check out All Things Policy, a daily public policy podcast that covers everything from employment figures to aircraft carriers. Tune in from Monday to Friday for new episodes and fresh takes.
Come learn and experience the ABCDs of being queer with me, Shunetro.
And me, Farhad.
On our show, Gay BCD.
The two of us take you through our stories and experiences of being gay men in the city of Mumbai and have candid
and sometimes downright scandalous
conversations about sexuality, gay culture, and everything in between.
Catch new episodes of Gay BCD every Tuesday on the IVM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get all your podcasts from.